guess I remind what was happening last time. It was so brief, so I repeated. Namely, how from kind of concepts of physical concepts, of kind of interpretations, we arrive at usual measure spaces and resolved kind of packages, and were significant for us related to entropy, and namely, this is Kolmogorov's dynamic entropy. So the issue which was in ergodic theory for about a decade before Kolmogorov entered was as follows. So in general, so I have abstract measure space, and abstract measure space for this purpose, you can think about this as a unit square. Usually say unit interval, I prefer square. It's certainly kind of easier to make a sketch. One-dimensional things are invisible, right? Then you have a self-mapping on it. And this self-mapping is a measurable map. So it's map which preserves measurable subsets and preserves the measures, just automorphism. I've forgotten my notation. So each notation I use is not F, it's transformation. Yeah, that should be G. And then if you have another such transformation, it's one measure space called X, into another measure space, call it Y, this can be U. So these make a category where, so measure spaces, as I said, as I explained, they can be things geometrically, just like squares on the plate, or defined abstractly as functors in the category of finite measure spaces. And this equivalence is the only kind of where measure theory enters. If you work only in the language for these functors, much of what I say is material, just as I said, all Kolmogorov thing reduces to that one line trivial computation. But anyway, abstractly, so I have one measure space and another. This transformation acting on them, and then morphisms are measure preserving maps, which by no means bijective, right? But then it's certainly surjective, such that they commute with this transformation, such that this G and this U, one goes into another. Very often people identify a priori two spaces, because all measure spaces kind of the same, yet all isomorphic. But this is same like all sets are, or given cardinality are the same. So identifying them immediately create tremendous terminological problems. So usually language of, they have conjugate, semi-conjugate, horrible language and dynamics, exactly because they identify beforehand two different spaces. Right? This is a category, and in this category we work, we want to find something from this category, and in particular, we want to know when two objects in this category are isomorphic, right? So given two such things, X and Y, when X isomorphic to Y, which means any category errors in two directions. But again, it's much easier to speak when you have two different spaces. When they're on the same space, X, you lost in notations because they serve different purposes. This is one of the difficulties in general in exposition of dynamic and ergodic theory. It's completely kind of incorrect language, and we have to explain things. I think it's simpler, people who say it, but actually this, you can cut by a factor of two or three any of those papers just making language correct. Well, I mean, it may have changed, of course. I haven't followed this for the last 20 years. My collection is somewhat older, I must admit. I don't know how people say. If still they use conjugate, then the conjugate transformations, still they use this language, or semi-conjugate, no? It's horrible, I mean, just. That's horrible. Okay, so, and the basic example from abstract point of view, well, this transformation is how to describe it. But there is canonical space, canonical transformations. When you take some group, first defined, it's nice to have for any group gamma acting on space. Actually, it doesn't have to be transformation. It may be the whole group gamma acting here and the same gamma acting there. Actually, groups may be also different. Right? Actually, you can say the groups are different, and then the whole errors was in homomorphism between groups. Let's say groups are the same. And so given any group, there is a simple class of measure spaces where it acts defined by products. Namely, you start with the finite probability space P and take it to the power gamma, which means you consider all functions from gamma to this P. So another way is these sets indexed by gamma of numbers P's between of positive numbers and the probability space or so called smooth one. And the point you can consider this infinite product of space, as I explained, this is one of the basic construction measure theory and probability taking products. I don't know whether it was it first formalized by Kolmogorov or was known before him. So, and second, I return to that and explain how it's done. But anyway, there is, it's product and there is a natural kind of measure structure in it if this was finite measure space. And natural meaning it agrees with all these old obvious maps. So if you have this product and you have a subset delta in gamma, then this product, P to the gamma, of course goes away, just restrict function to delta. And this structure, the only condition, will be compatible with these errors, right, in this functorial language. So you don't use anything else, yeah, of this infinite object. But of course you use property of which we do know of this finite category, right? So you have this kind of the most basic dynamical system, a basic action of gamma on a measure space, and this infinite product space. And then the question is, given two action, this is a very kind of elementary question. You don't want, and it's unclear to me the meaning of an abstract question for general dynamical system, general actions, when they're isomorphic, when the two are isomorphic. Because here you know the answer must be simple. It depends only on P and Q. In each P and Q, you just finite collection of numbers, right? So this is beauty of this question is extremely, is extreme simplicity of the expected answer, right? So what is the P? P is collection of numbers, and Q is a finite collection of positive numbers. So looking at this array of positive numbers, you want to say if this is isomorphic or not for given gamma. And the answer is still unknown in general, right? The answer is unknown in general. And it was, nothing was known until Kolmogorov, and so he was his proven. And as I explain, I remind just in a second I show the basic kind of ingredients of the proof, which in our language become kind of tautology, is that if this isomorphic gives to the gamma, in fact, he proved it for gamma equals z, but this is the integers, but this applies to a large class of groups, then it follows that entropy is equal of the two spaces. And the entropy, as you know, can be computed by a Boltzmann formula. So entropy of Pi so entropy of the space P, so we define equal minus sum. Minus is conventional, because for this theory minus plays no role. Pi log Pi, it is summation. And the minus just to have it positive. Actually, in a second I come up with the similar expression, which will be on the contrary negative. And you again change the sign to have it positive. And this is a kind of quite simple theorem. And then it was, at some point, it was reversed by, probably his name is Ornstein, yeah? That there is, this also true in both directions. There is a opposite arrow as well. So entropy, equality of entropies implies that spaces are the dynamics are isomorphic. There is some controversy with how much the opposite theorem is relevant. It's is by far more difficult. The proof is really difficult. You have to produce transformation. On the other hand, it's unclear what's the point of this. Yeah? The one theorem tells you something specific, rather concrete. You have, you observe. So the meaning of that is, physically, when you observe a crystal, no matter how you measure it, you get the same entropy, right? So this is, you can think about this as a kind of one-dimensional crystals represented in different ways with P and Q. You see it in different coordinates. This P and Q is kind of coordinates in which you see, and we see in a different coordinate system, we see the same result. And opposite theorem says, well, if you always say see the same result, the kind of system is the same. And it's unclear, kind of significant, this kind of deep theorem, but I must admit I don't understand the significance. For me, it looks kind of very complex, very deep, profound theorem, but unlike Kolmogorov, it has no kind of something, which is some kind of artifact of the language. But of course, in Ornstein theory, is much more than that. He proves much more. It's quite refined theory of that, but this doesn't seem to. I think eventually this theorem would find kind of place in something, some categorical approach, but this hasn't been developed. For the moment, it doesn't exist. So that's the theorem. So we temporarily forget about that. There is a weak result, most kind of due to Sinai, which says, in a way, the same up to kind of exponentially small error. It gave you this equality before. So, and this was kind of interestingly enough, before that, for some time, people had no idea when these two systems are isomorphic, what makes them different. So, how to look at the system and say something about them. And so, but the corresponding answer, so, and this theorem is true for all amenable groups gamma. So, let me say what is amenable. In this terminology, it says that gamma is. It's a countable group for now purpose. So it's represented, it can be exhausted of subsets. At increasing sequence of finite subsets, such that if you take this subset and multiply it by any fixed subset and compare this cardinality, and product means I take a product of all elements and compare their cardinality, that goes to one. So it means there exists this sequence. For example, if you have integers, so you just take a system in increasing sequence of intervals. In a Euclidean, in abelian groups, you take increasing, free abelian groups, you take increasing sequence of finite subsets. So it's well approximable in a way by finite sets, in some sense. You can say it. You see, most of the product doesn't bring you out of the delta n. When you multiply it by some elements, it kind of basically remain there. Right? And so this was proven by Kolmogorov. And then recently, and maybe yes, I remind you the ingredients of the proof, how you do that. The kind of the basic thing involved. So this is how you define product. Again, there is some. Then if you want to identify these infinite products of some of them with the standard interval with standard measure space, you need this Lebesgue density lemma, but again, this elementary kind of have nothing to do with dynamics. You have to reformulate in these terms, it's kind of rather trivial matter. And the point is that this entropy of dynamical system is defined for any system of transformations. It has nothing to do with the group or with the billion groups or whatever. It's always well defined. The question is if we give you useful answers. Right? So if you do it, say, for free groups, whatever, you get always infinity or zero or something, and you are nowhere. You get infinity, actually. Yeah. But once you have it, you make this computation using this. This is kind of the basic formula we should use. You use this relative Shannon formula. And so let me remind it in a nice language, relative Shannon formula, or Shannon inequality, I'm sorry. It says we have two morphisms between finite measure spaces. That entropy of this, it's very simple to remember, is less or equal to entropy of F1 plus entropy of F2. But you see, it's this is exactly where it's nice to have things for errors. And this is a kind of operation which corresponds to joining partition in measure spaces. So secretly, if you stick to the old-fashioned measure theory, these finite measure spaces are obtained by subdividing your interval into finitely many pieces and assigning to each piece weight of this interval. And when you have, so it's better to see in the square, because you have this partition, and then have this partition, and then dividing into squares corresponds to this join operation. This is why square is much better. In fact, the full picture, this inequality even better is preceding the cube that I was explaining in this Loomis-Whitney theorem is demonstrating that. Okay. And so this has nothing to do with groups, whatever. It's a very formal property which you have to verify. And then it will come, it was too high. Then look this way. And but when it comes to actual proof of Kolmogorov, so what happens? You just exhaust indeed this. You just apply this for exhaustion by intervals. And the only this limit inequality is the only thing which you use. So in a way, specifically what Kolmogorov uses, that this n plus i divided by n converges to 1 when it goes to infinity. It's kind of maybe a little bit caricature on the proof, but everything else has nothing to do with the subject. It's just generic stuff. And here it's amenability of the group which enters. And this is was always a narrow neck in this argument, and people at some moment started to believe it may be completely false for other groups. But then, as I said recently, it was proven by Louis Boyen that it is true, and it's true for so-called Sophie groups. Let me say a couple of words with them, because these are quite amusing concept. And which proven to be Vichy. Yeah. So another point, of course, why mathematicians couldn't prove it, 100 years earlier, the theorem. That's for me a mystery. Why, it was ergodic theory, Tratatau, Birgov theorem, all this kind of abstract nonsense. And the kind of the most elementary stuff which physicists always were doing. Yeah. You're looking at crystal, measuring the entropy, and showing that entropy doesn't depend how you measure. And they kind of knew that in a way. Mathematicians could never pick it up. Unless it was when the first was Shannon, who actually rewritten Boltzmann in discrete language. So right from mathematical point of view, the difference between Shannon and Boltzmann, that Boltzmann using natural logs and Shannon was using clock mode 2, right? Interpreting them as bits, which is of course nice. And by the way, even now you can find discussion in information theoretical people, they're proving various theorems using this language. And it's horrible, I mean, it depends on what kind of, it appeals to stock market. You say you buy these stocks, you sell these stocks, and that thing helps to understand, right? Of course, natural log is much more convenient for computational, but for any formula is much better. Log 2 is nice for purposes used for Shannon, but mathematics, of course, was known to Gibson, to Boltzmann and Gibson, they manipulated this completely freely. However, mathematicians couldn't do that. That's because, and then when Shannon did it, and then Kolmogorov understood Shannon, and then he actually done it. Right? Because already it was in Shannon, of course. All the formulas or formalism were in Shannon. And Kolmogorov just put it in this framework. It's rather bizarre. I don't quite understand that. There was a big gap between mathematicians and physicists, yeah. But then there was this. So this problem is still unknown in general. So is it true that this isomorphism implies entropy is equal? And it's nice. It's a very simple question, yeah. You don't have to know much about general measure spaces. It's just, it's not even true, I think, clear even for continuous maps, whatever. So this is widely open. And apparently the issue, of course, is not about that, but about notion of a group to which it applies. And Boyen proved, say, for free groups first, and then for so-called Sophie groups. So let me say a few words about them. concept which is kind of ideologically very close to what I'm saying, because much of Boltzmann writing and many other physicists implicitly used non-standard analysis. And again, non-standard analysis was known since Leibniz. And Leibniz actually introduced it, but then mathematicians kind of were unhappy without that. Because, you see, because there was kind of a concept of rigor which was not grasping, not encompassing all mathematics of the time. And I think it's partly could have been influenced by Berkeley. He wrote like a bunch of influential, extremely stupid things about calculus foundation. Calculus was kind of sheer nonsense, but however, very influential one. And it was influential till the beginning of the 20th century. You can see account the history of mathematics saying it was a great text. If you read what written there, it's gibberish, yes, sheer gibberish. But apparently it has influenced mathematicians. And so they, instead of thinking, they were just trying to be kind of closing their eyes to obvious things, like non-standard analysis. But of course, for physics, it was obvious thing, manipulate with them, it certainly was not. It's trivially seen, really no contradiction, if you don't make a mistake. And so what are surface groups? What's non-standard about them? So one of the definition is, which is, must be in this, here the point, because I'm coming in the second part of my lecture using this kind of philosophy of non-standard analysis more, you operate with infinite objects. You, in particular, when you speak about measure spaces, we already had it. In order to understand one space P, we take n, and n goes to infinity. But it's convenient to have this n this infinite large number, not to make it variable. So it's otherwise your notation become much more flexible. It's just one number, but infinite large. At every moment, you can kind of change this concept of large. It's fluid, and this is one of the possibilities of the language, mathematical language. Now we know, we just check our language, no, it works and just can go freely with this. Yeah? You don't have to stick to epsilon, delta, whatever, particular language. And now I want to define surface groups in this kind of language and say, yeah. So gamma is, the group is gamma, if it can be represented by a subgroup in the permutation group, symmetric group, but this n infinity, infinite large. It's not infinity in the sense being uncountable. It's infinity in the sense of, being non-standard large number. And then you have to decipher it. And when you start deciphering, you immediately see that there are various possibilities, right? You have to specify the language, and it's, again, it's the same like in category theory. By itself, it doesn't prove anything. But it tells you immediately what you have to check, where you have to go. And so it gives you a very compact way to make conjectures, a very easy way to formulate theorems. But then you have to, you know, to see what happens. But this verification is trivial. Once you know where you go, you just go. You don't have to think, right? And this, in this respect, non-standard analysis is similar to category theory. It's convenient language. It allows you to cut off junk of notations and thinking, yeah. So. Now we have to decipher this. So another way to say it, that this group and this class of gamma, so gamma is suffix, yeah. And I think it's a, if, again, it acts on these spaces. Another way to say it, you can see this kind of proper limit, it's called outer limit of finite permutation group, and you go to the limit. And so I have this compact group, non-standard compact group, and this may be subgroup of this group. And this agrees with the concept of the group being residually finite. So in one sense, I saw this amenable groups are approximately x in finite sense. So it can be approximated. So this, when I say limit, means it's approximation, of course, right? Because this is a limit. So it might be approximated by finite permutations, by finite groups. And so residually finite group, gamma, are exactly those groups which can act by symmetries on compact metric spaces. I don't want to write because I already wrote it, so here. Yeah. So that definition of residually finite. So again, in both cases, compact spaces are the ones which are well approximated, of course, by finite spaces. So So this is also action approximable by finite action in a different sense. And now we want to give this full definition. So I guess I put it there. Then I had to write it because it was already written twice. So we want some closeness between objects, and we have to say that one action close to another action in a second. So we have this concept of two maps being close. Okay, so if they differ on a subset, so two maps applied to a finite set, no matter where they go, called epsilon close, or epsilon agree, yeah, up to R epsilon, if the subset where they are different constitute only 1 over epsilon of total of totality of the points. Right? This is how we measure. The moment we set this measurement, we can speak about what is called outer limits or limits, or all this non-standard stuff. Right? That because there is kind of a measure. So when you use non-standard analysis, you need kind of unit, measure of unity, how to go to the limits. And now we have to kind of say it. What happens now, once you have it, you say group approximately X and finite set. So first, again, we introduce this concept. What does it mean? There is a epsilon monomorphisms of the group into the permutation group of a finite set. Right? So you have or any set for that matter. So it must act there, but at every moment when you make composition of maps, whatever, all equalities, the maps are equal only up to R epsilon. R epsilon meaning outside of a set whose relative measure is epsilon, is only epsilon percent shell points. So it's quite a reasonable notion. Of course, you can introduce other topologies, other measurements, and you get different classes of groups, and it's unclear if all of them are equal. There is a very close class of groups called, I think, hyperlinear or something introduced by Alan Kohn earlier, and it's unknown if the classes are equal. Because it's again, you use some limit, but with different topology. And we can, probably there are many different classes we can introduce, but this happened to be kind of, it's an extremal case in a way. Because L1 metric is extremal. And these are usually very special. For entropy, not surprisingly. And so if the group admits such an approximate action for every epsilon and for any subset, a finite subset, on somewhere on some finite set, it's called sophic. It's not so clear, of course, so what class of groups you have, but it's kind of clear that amenable groups and these residual finite groups are in this category. So in particular, all linear groups, all abelian groups, all manipulation you do with them, their subgroups, whatever, they're all in this category. So it's a big category, big class, well, category meaning class. But apparently they're very special, so we don't know. This is a little bit embarrassing, so we don't have counter example. I think no matter where you look, kind of you have counter example, but we cannot prove it. And this is annoying. And I guess once you have it, you will have also counter example to this property that two power spaces to gamma power, is called Bernoulli shifts sometimes, of a group, they are isomorphic, probably they will not give you, don't have to have the same entropy, and they all probably will be isomorphic. So that's naive conjecture, yeah, that being sophic is necessarily insufficient to have ergodic theory. But for the moment, because we cannot say sophic or non-sophic, it remains problematic. Okay, so this was more or less repetition of what was last time. And the point was that starting from this kind of physical perspective, you have a crystal and you measure its entropy as the number of states. How you measure it, you take some machine, you move it around and measure only with this machine. And sometimes you can put this machine in two different positions and measure with this, yeah. And just doing that, you find this entropy. And in fact, no matter how you position them, you get different results. So a priori, you may have many entropies. A posteriori, it's not the case. But if given any systematic way of measurements, you get the same result. And this entropy doesn't depend on how you measure it. And it's intrinsic to the system. when it is what is feasible, because a system without interaction. It's non-interacting particles, and so this kind of very trivial system. But, and in a way, of course, if you make particular kind of coordinate system, this PI is the service coordinates, and if things change from coordinates to coordinates, not that you say, aha, everything is wrong, it's just you have to change your concept, right? When you measure certain quantities in the space, you take a affine transformation, of course, length changes. It doesn't mean that geometry become faulty, it just means you have to introduce different kind of rules of change, of coordinate change. Therefore, even if some groups think it will not turn out in such a simple way, they probably turn out in a more interesting way. So this, when you change, you apply a transformation between two things, the change will depend on some invariant of this transformation, so nothing wrong. But we don't have this theory because there is no objects which can be applied. But now I want to turn to different subject, because I want to give kind of, and this is about a geometric kind of way to think about probability and entropy specifically. And there were kind of two motivations. One, we introduced by Fisher geometric thinking, and in context of mathematical biology. And because you see, because there is kind of this Fisher metric in the space of probability distribution on a set. So when you fix a set, and you vary these PIs. So this is a simplex, right? And so it becomes kind of geometric. Now you speak of probability, you have the simplex, and just talk about the simplex. And this point, I don't know where it first was emphasized, but definitely in the work by Fisher, who was interested in mathematical biology, and he was proving various theorems about this metric. And it's kind of funny, because this metric sometimes called by people in biology, mathematical, is still called Shanshahani metric, who introduced it. And some people called Rao metric, which was kind of before Shanshahani. And Shanshahani somewhere in the late 70s, and they say, okay, all these properties of this metric were proven by Fisher. Many properties, and they're proven, so it's unclear. So I think the word metric, Fisher probably didn't use the word metric. And in a second, just I explain the reason he was a little bit reluctant to use the word metric. However, so we want to find natural metrics in the space of these probability distributions. So what will be, I start with the last. I'm not certain, at some moment I found the reference to this paper by Fisher, but now I couldn't. People all say Fisher would never mention the paper. I think it was in the 20s, and at some moment I found it, spending one day searching on the net, but then I couldn't find it. People don't refer to that, which is, I think, unfortunate. Because it's quite, I will be not surprised that in this paper by Fisher, there is more than usually extracted from the paper. Right? This, I know this happens for more modern authors who kind of have this kind of, who introduce new concepts and people refer to them and then they miss half or two-thirds of what's written in the original papers. But it's maybe true also about Fisher paper. He was certainly a smart guy. But apparently I think quite nice, yeah? I read about him a little bit. So I start with the last kind of definition because most natural and probably the one, maybe first we discuss a little bit. Prior to that, something about the simplex. So first, this category of measure spaces may be seen as some ornamentation of the category of simplices and simplicial maps. So category of finite sets can be thought of, and I don't know the right word, it's canonically equivalent, but it's not quite, I'm not certain here again there is the right terminology, as a category of simplicial maps, because every finite set uniquely defines the simplex, and every maps between finite set induces unique simplicial map between simplices. It looks like just nothing. However, just to explain why it is highly non-trivial operation, this change of perspective is. So So we have a category of finite set. And this looks something extremely discrete and nothing is topological. Now you take simplices. So you interpret this category in this language. It's the same category, right? These are canonically, I don't know how you can say. They're not isomorphic, it's just kind of the same, except for interpretation. And then you say, consider covariant, contravariant functors from this category to category of sets. Take this. And then you just realize, if you think in simplicial terms, they become semi-simplicial spaces. And so the theory of the space, algebraic topology. So if you reinterpret that, you immediately have all algebraic topology in your laps. Of course, you have to prove theorem, but that's kind of trivial. However, if you say in terms of sets, you never see that. In fact, by the way, when people speak of semi-simplicial sets, they make some, for some reason, don't understand, they introduce, simplicity, the generation, just completely irrelevant. What it is, it's a functor, and this is a very simple functor. If we have simplicial complex, so a bunch of simplices glued together, then for every simplex, we can consider all the set will be all simplicial map from this simplex there. That's a functor. And that's all, and it's functorial, because when you go to a face, it agrees with projection. That's it. And all algebraic topology can be expressed in this language. You cannot prove maybe too much, but you have immediately the language. We can question this. Yeah. And there are other interpretations, by the way, of that, of this category of finite set. You can implement them by different, physical, so to speak, models, and you have different, completely different kind of avenues of thinking. And for us, so it is measured, it's a measure space from this point of view, it's such a simplex, plus a point in the simplex. It's a measure, right? It's given by bodycentric coordinates. And again, morphisms will be, again, this simplicial map, but such that this point goes to this point. So you can rigidify a little bit this category, so you have essentially the same morphisms, but you have more spaces, yeah. It's still sufficient. So that's what happens here. So this is a category, and then you think how far you can go in terms of simplices, what kind of geometry. I'll say a couple of words because we shall come to this later if there is a time in the context of Mendelian dynamics. Is what? Yeah, so one I'm using point, which is kind of always, of course, implicit in any books on probability, but never said explicitly, that this simplex can be seen, is a limit of purely combinatorial objects. In the combinatorial object, you take this underlying set, take at nth Cartesian power, and divide by permutation of the coordinates. When you go to the limit, you converge to the simplex. Because, this is explained why it is so. It's kind of trivial, right? Because you see, the action of this looks big space, this exponential power space, but this group of permutation much bigger. It's n factorial much bigger than power. So essentially, it acts almost transitively. So what remains is very little. And this, of course, this symmetry is everywhere in probability theory, in statistical mechanics, and just in my following lecture, explain how to exploit it in a much deeper way. This is very, of course, it's rather superficial. But still, it's kind of nice. And entropy, I will not explain today, may be also seen in terms of the symmetry. But so is the symmetry. And then there are other operations which dimension, cardinality goes tremendously down from exponential goes in n, it becomes polynomial. So polynomial is nothing compared to exponential. So in a way, this action is transitive or ergodic. And that's quite essential, by the way, in this sophic kind of theory. I must admit, I haven't thought for myself the definition of sophic to explain it effortlessly. It always requires a little bit effort. It's not, and I'm pretty certain it can be brought also to purely categorical language. If you put the nice setting, you don't have to write a single formula. But at the moment, it's not so. You need some computation. But then this computation, this map. So we have operation of Cartesian product on probability spaces. And algebraically, it means the following. It's not so trivial map from product of Euclidean spaces to their tensor product. And this is just, you take tensor, and you multiply units, and you have this map. And this is highly nonlinear map. It's kind of complicated polynomial map, and just much algebraic geometry is associated to this map, yeah. It's just where nonlinearity for algebraic equation come from. And for simplices, so you have this particular map also. So you embed product of the small simplices to the big simplex. And in instance to that, this is called Segre map, and we shall we will be returning to this important instance of that, or a special case, part of this is called Veronese map. You take all factors being equal, and you restrict everything to the diagonal. And then symmetry responds to what? That you go to the symmetric power, symmetric tensorial power of Euclidean space, and this is just the space of polynomials. And the map is very simple. So how it works? It looks very innocuous, but it's not at all. And the geometry of this has many, many remarkable features. You just have, you think about your vectors as linear forms. Variables M, so it is summation Li, I prefer IPI. Xi, and you take it power n, and then you have now a polynomial of degree n. So you map space of linear polynomials to the space of high degree polynomials, but Euclidean space goes to high degree Euclidean space. A particular instance of that, just to explain, it's highly, it may look kind of, nothing to do, you know, just completely trivial, but it's extremely non-trivial and rather poorly understood yet. Just in the simplest case where equals 2. Right? So you map, you go from R M, if I'm not mistaken, to R M plus 1. This is a number, no? So from R3, you go to R6, yeah? Is that, get you right, yeah? Right. So this is, my numbers are right. From R2, you go to R3, right? So it's quadratic. So this is quite a remarkable map, and just property of this map, very essential. This kind of maps were inside of this. Remember, we had this Mendelian discussion of the Mendel map, which was this kind of map. And they have kind of remarkable properties, some not so obvious, and because now, actually Hardy was, you know, he was a hero of the formula, but I don't think he has a picture of that. At least he didn't mention that. Let me just say so what interesting about already about this map, just for the case R3 goes to R6. And you look what happens to the sphere, and it goes here. So first, the sphere will be contained in some affine five-dimensional space. So you take linear form, take a square, have quadratic form. So this is space of all quadratic forms, six-dimensional space of quadratic forms. However, the one which you can see, the one on the unit sphere, this form has trace one. And therefore, they're like in the subspace corresponding to trace one. So they're like in the five-dimensional space. So it's a kind of, and secondly, it was a sphere will factors, it goes here, it factors by a projective plane. Because the quadratic form is symmetric, plus minus the same, right? So what you have this kind of particular embedding of projective plane to five-dimensional space. And so, it's a kind of one of the most kind of fundamental objects, exactly for this dimension, or maybe for higher dimensions, one of the most fundamental objects in mathematics, and particularly in quantum mechanics. Because, you see, so what happens, so you have this high dimensional space, and here there is a sphere, and the convex hull, convex cone over that, give you all positive definite forms. So this extremal point, this is a set of extremal points in the space of positive definite forms, or as the physicists would say, self-adjoint operators, positive self-adjoint operators, which corresponds to statistical physical state in quantum mechanics if you go to the complex numbers, which for us immaterial. Yeah, we will be working with real numbers, mathematical part we will discuss, not dependent complex numbers. But so if in classical probability, this is a cone, yeah, it's just positive number, it's kind of only invariant under the permutation group of coordinates, so it has these corners, yeah. This is much smoother, see. This is a set of extremal point is now not finite set, but projective plane. So kind of formally, you started with finite set and permutation group, same cardinality M, acting on that. And now you start with a projective space of dimension M and orthogonal group acting there. So you replace this group by this. I don't know the formula just because it's a wild group or something, yeah? Why the theory is kind of, these transportation of theories. Much of what you were saying remains true if you say it correctly. But this is the fact. And this is a kind of, this kind of game in mathematics you play very often. You just make something similar, they look removed, very different, but eventually, but amazingly kind of many things. But of course there is no kind of unique approach to that, yeah. And you don't know what happens to other symmetries or other categories, whatever, but of course it's suggestive. So in both cases, this is a kind of maximally symmetric object with respect to the action of this group, right? A permutation group cannot act on any smaller set, and also orthogonal group cannot act on any smaller manifold or smaller dimension. So they're maximally symmetric object, and out of them, this thing arises. So, but about this projective plane, just let me ask a specific question, which I think is an answer to that, yeah? So, this is a projective plane, say, of dimension M, sitting in the Euclidean space of dimension, I think M. Minus one or something. So for two, it must go to five, right? Two, three. No, it's M plus one. So it always embeds projective space to this Euclidean space. The question which is unknown for large M. So you want to understand geometry of this here. And the question you may ask is as follows. So it is fully homogeneous, yeah. It's orthogonal group acts there fully transitively. So it's everywhere the same. But the metric you have ambient, it's not the intrinsic metric, it's kind of curved. So you kind of this projection space curved in a certain way. And so to understand its shape is not so easy, and here is the question. So what is the minimal number? Minimal number. Call it K. Such that this space with induced Euclidean metric may be covered by K subset of diameter less or equal than one. When I say one, I normalize the size to have diameter one of the whole thing. Okay? Because you see the circle point, each point has a very big complementary set, which is maximally removed from them. And the question, for example, if it grows exponentially, polynomially, whatever. And I think if you think about that, it provides conjectures. Can count the example, but now it's known to conjectures of Borsuk and just many other conceivable conjectures. So its geometry is not at all transparent, yeah. And it's related, of course, to a property of matrices and analysis of matrices, etc. So these maps must be respected, despite the fact that they look quite simple-minded. Okay, so. We stop here, and then in the next lecture explain more about that. And so this, when you go to symmetric tensors, they look kind of no big deal when you change that. But of course, like in the previous example, now on the level of linear algebra, you change pictures significantly. And of course, this must be relevant in probability theory, but our definition of entropy, we are not exploiting this symmetry. And actually, this becomes even more significant in the phenomenon entropy, because there is not many visible invariants of the symmetric group as it acts on sets, but there are lots of kind of structure and acts on the linear space, but because you know the representation theory of the symmetric group. By the way, so what people say who understand representation theory of finite groups, they say is the only theory which exists in the theory of permutation group. Everything else is just words, but this is quite amazing theory which I have no idea of, but it certainly must end. Now I want to discuss some metrics associated to entropy. And so I want to start with the last one, because it is the most natural. It's called Fisher metric, yeah. So it's a metric in the space of probability distribution on a finite set, so it's a simplex. And we just want to define some metric there. And what will be the most natural metric? And the one which, and this is, well, common in differential geometry, and apparently I don't know in what form it was introduced by Fisher, but the logic is quite simple. So you have some geometric objects, and you want to introduce metrics, so it must be metric on the tangent space at every point on the tangent space. So they defined by, they spread over some spaces. So if at every point you have a metric, or remind me, you can integrate this metric. And then you have a Riemannian metric in this space. And this example in Riemannian geometry is common, like the space of all Riemannian metric on a smooth manifold, right? And at every point, the quadratic forms, there is some metric. So you take distance infinitesimal at every point of value of this quadratic form, and then integrate it with the whole manifold over the very form, over the measure defined by the metric. And this kind of, it's not work for all structures. You need measure there. But here it's extremely easy. And so what you do is, this is the kind of formally what you do. It's kind of trivial, but first, so it's easy because you have to compare different points. In the different points, you have to, metrics a priori different. For example, you have a real line here and real line here is the fine space, the additive group. You only can compare them up to a constant. And so you just don't have a consistent thing everywhere. You know, there is one. When I write real numbers, there is zero, there is also one. But one is an artifact. It's not in the group structure, you just choose an element. And if you don't have it, you don't have it. And now our group is multiplicative group, right? The space of measures on a finite set is naturally acted by multiplicative group. Probability is kind of numbers, they're kind of additive. But the symmetry is multiplicative group. I was mentioning before, yes, this scaling may look trivial matter, but it's fundamental in probability. It's always there, even if you're not aware of that. And so in the space of metric, you have action of this group. But when it acts there, so you just have a bunch of PIs, it's kind of trivial. But otherwise, if you don't say what they say, people write some metrics, some formulas, and Fisher wrote some formulas, which I'm unable even to read, yeah, I mean. Because what I'm saying is worse than the formulas. They have no kind of anything computational about them, right? There are formulas like written by Ramanujan, they are formulas. But there are things which just should be said in words. If you write a formula, you just use wrong language. So you have these weights, P1, P2, ta da da da. And you can multiply them by lambda, which is positive. You put everywhere lambda. So they go out of probability space immediately, of course, right? So you have that. But when you have it, at each point, in particular, you have this action of the same group. So whichever left invariant metric you take on the multiplicative group, of course, accidentally, a posteriori, you know, is isomorphic to additive group, but this, you know, it comes later on. It gives you this metric at every single point. And this has a Riemannian metric. So I take the Riemannian metric at every point, and then summate over all p's. This metric understanding is quadratic form. So it gives you on a simplex, at every point, it gives you a quadratic form. Positive, definite, quadratic form, observe that. And then there is a metric attached to it. And of course, it's very easy to write it down in additive coordinates, and it will be the metric. If it will be. This is kind of normalization coming from this, because it was multiplicative group. And we use left invariant metric on the multiplicative group. And this is a metric. It's Riemannian metric, you see. From that we can make a distance, of course. So it's one definition. And it gives this formula. So I'll give you kind of three definitions giving the same formula. And I don't know, I guess all of you know Anto Fischer. I don't know which one he used, because when you write formulas, they all have the same. You write this formula, they're all the same, but they have completely different meaning. And when you start generalizing them, you run in different worlds. Yeah. Second definition depends on what is called conditional entropy. So this we was discussing anyway. Now lambda now is a measure and a mu measure. And this actually the condition is may look kind of sophisticated, but of course this was how originally entropy was introduced by Boltzmann. It was not introduced on a discrete set, it was introduced like that. We have a background measure and with this n probability measure, and then a defined entropy. And specifically, a specific example was Euclidean space, or usually it was even dimensional space, kind of phase space. Well, anyway, Euclidean space, this is lambda, it's standard measure, it's even infinite. And then you have a function f of x on Rn, yeah? Such that in a positive function, not negative function, such that integral of f equals 1. So when you take this measure mu equal f times lambda, this will be probability measure. And for this, Boltzmann defines entropy. So let me make some little modification of what I was saying. Because before that, what we were having, our background space. So this is a kind of background space, and then there is probability distribution. In our previous example, basic example, our background space was essentially just, it was a finite set, all atoms of unit weight. So we could say we have countable set, all atoms of unit weight. This was your lambda. And over this, we were putting measure, which was probability measure in defining entropy. But the fact that this is background space was discrete was never used. And in a way, it may be, so how you can make general definitions of Euclidean space or for any space? You just divide it in small atoms, yeah, in equal weight, and put renormalized measure so it becomes one everywhere. And then we have this function, it's say function, say it's continuous. Otherwise, yeah, you have to just partition slightly carefully, replace it by these values. So you immediately go into the previous situation and go to the limit, one way. On the other hand, you can say how I can use the same definition we had before. And this may be even more advantageous. Here, maybe as clear it was before. Imagine function was constant on its support. And this is important case. So we have support of the function. It was equal to a certain value. And this value, of course, f of x, where it's not zero, equal 1 divided by, this is support of f, s. This, you know, the lambda measure. So it's volume of the set. And the entropy of this will be, of course, log of this volume. Right? A constant function. And now you can see it may be positive or negative. For atomic space will be always positive, this may become negative. Yeah. S may be smaller than kind of unit. And then you do the same game as before. This is the only kind of thing you have to know. Then you take this out of the n in this measure and take everything to the nth power. So we take here n's Cartesian power and here is tensorial power corresponding to this measure. And you say I have the law of large numbers, it becomes eventually almost constant on its support. So, and this, so we reduce the previous definition. So we take entropy, we take volume of this subset where it's approximately constant, take log and divide back by this number, by this power. And of course, all properties just to say either you repeat the proofs or you observe you can approximate this continuous measure by discrete. But there is a little bit tiny point. If you have arbitrary measure space, and there is a big kind of atom inside. And this atom you can't approximate by discrete. Well, so you have to, well, it's a material, of course. It's clear that once there is such a proof, it works in one context, it's completely universal and can be maybe even more general than I said, but of course there is a law of large numbers, and of course, in order to make this thing work in general, you have to say that this integral of f log f converges. You probably have to put here log f. Of course, you integrate only on the support, outside of the support you postulate as being zero, and if it doesn't converge, you have problems. And then, unsurprisingly, you have the Boltzmann formula, where it was written exactly for this case. And but then, amusing point is that if you apply it to two probability measures, so you have this entropy based on lambda of a measure mu, and this also was probability, this entropy, instead of being positive, becomes negative. And so people are high, change the sign. You won't see people like positivity. And then this called Kullback-Leibler divergence, if I'm not mistaken. Some people introduced it and became famous for that, because they changed the sign. I don't understand this history yet. It was probably looked upon from different perspective. Everything is, of course, in the concept of relative entropy is in Boltzmann. So Boltzmann was done. Of course, much more general, his context is more general than of Shannon. His mathematics was also more profound, because he was kind of attached to deeper questions. But anyway, that's interesting. For property, and so its function is like that. And it vanishes if and only if lambda equals to mu. If the two measures are equal, this is zero. And this is kind of, yes, completely obvious, of course. And once you have such a function in two variables, now it's function simplex in two variables, right? And this is much better than just one entropy function, two variables. So you have function P in Q. And the function is positive and vanishes on the diagonal. Then it always defines a Riemannian metric on the space, which may become degenerate because function were identically zero after all. But this function is sufficient. It's a smooth function, by the way. It's a smooth function up to the diagonal. And this is quite simple how we do that. So because it vanishes when two are equal, if you look at one particular point, so it looks like that. So it's positive and vanishes at this point because everywhere positive. First differential is zero. Right, it's tension. And then the second differential, because it goes up, it's my positive semi-definite. So second differential of this function with respect to P at every point P is going to give you quadratic differential form on the simplex. And you see, we don't use any structure in the simplex except for its smooth structure. You see, it's second differential, it's not Hessian. In the second Hessian will appear, which depends on other structures. But this is very applies to any smooth manifold. This, by the way, applies to usual Riemannian manifold. If you forget concept of Riemannian manifold, only remember distance between two points. And you take a square x, y. This is a smooth function at zero, and Riemannian metric defined, but that's original Riemannian metric. Right, so from Riemannian metric to the distance, it can go both ways. Of course, distance a priori carries more information, distance function in two variables. Riemannian metric is several functions, but in one variable, meaning one x. So, and for that reason, in fact, a distance is per se as function of two variables beyond grasp. Yeah, it's two general objects. You cannot work with them. They provide you with a language, but you cannot prove anything about them. You cannot verify given function of two variables. It's vice triangular inequality. It's just inconceivable how you can check it, right? It's absolutely, given this concrete function, like matrix, I guess is what they call NP problem. It's kind of transcendentally complicated problem. But if you can localize like Riemannian metric, that's the beauty of that. It reduces the subject very simple, just finitely many functions, the manifold defined via metric. Right? As function one variable, and these are kind of world of difference. function one variable, even many of them function two variables. Everything is function two variables. Any mathematical object can be described as a function two variables, but not as one variable. Okay, but anyway, that's the point. So I think, and if you do that, and you make still one line computation, so I have it somewhere. It was here, and you see that you get the same metric. So this is called information divergence for these two guys, which you never forget. So this is just, I repeat what I said here. And then by, you know, for this there is Boltzmann formula. This is Boltzmann formula, discrete case. This is for discrete case. So you apply this Boltzmann formula, make this computation. And you have the same, we have this metric we had before. Now I'm going backwards from what I wrote. And now we come to the original, the same kind of, which may look. Now we define directly in terms of the entropy. These were more elaborate quantities, they're kind of more natural, but in a way more elaborate. But now we're coming back to the entropy, as is written in this PI log PI form. And take it Hessian. Now Hessian, unlike second differential, see, it depends on the affine structure, not defined in general. So I have this function. So second derivative, you have a function like that. It's second derivative, so to speak, intrinsically defined only here, but not here. Here it depends on the parameter. However, because the symplex is a fine space, so it still makes sense. So Hessian is a quadratic form. Makes sense. You cannot say what is second derivative, but as a form is defined because space is defined. You see? So Hessian is defined. And again, you have this quadratic form, and therefore you have Riemannian metric on the simplex, and they all have the same form, yeah? They all, as I wrote, because you have the Boltzmann formula for everybody, for the second two, they always be like that, dpi squared. So what is this metric now? So first it's easy to write it down, of course, because everything diagonal, yeah? It's so easy to write because it's diagonal. And the remarkable thing, yes, if you don't know, it's kind of unbelievable, that this metric has constant positive curvature. And I see it is remarkable in a variety of respects. First, a priori, try to compute this curvature, you'll die. I mean. People say curvature is good for it. I'm proving something asymmetric or non-asymmetric. Curvature isn't computable, usually. It's horrible, yeah? No. It just, you say this word, but you never computed it. In a way, of course, in very special cases. But when it's given by formulas, it's completely hopeless. And actually, well, I mean, eventually, today, maybe, next time, I bring some examples. Or some instances when people computed and they just die while trying to compute curvature, very simple metrics. You know, pages, you know, take two black balls to write with just curvature, very simple metric, incredibly complicated. However, you can prove it. If you, because the point is, the simplex with this metric is just isometric to the spherical simplex of the sphere, this corresponding part of the sphere inside of this positive cone of the metric. And the map is extremely simple. You go from the point of the sphere, you go to the point s squared. Right? And because sum of s squared is 1, so the sphere goes to the simplex. You just take squares of coordinates. And this is quite a remarkable map. It's certainly most remarkable in the complex domain. So maybe I mentioned what is true about complex domain. It's just for complex numbers. You take complex number z, and then you go to norm z squared. So you map complex numbers, you map to positive real numbers. And this is a kind of a basic moment map. And the map has a remarkable property, which is was discovered by Archimedes and written in a different form, apparently on his tomb. It says this map is measure preserving, which is kind of unbelievable, right? It's a completely different space. It's a very complicated map, but measure preserving in a sense, of course, that if you take any subset here and pull it back, you have an annulus, and the measure of this annulus equals the measure of this interval. Well, maybe there is a rescaling, a point of normalization, of course, but this is the kind of the property. And the same is true in higher dimensions. There is a map from complex space to positive cone of measures, of measures, right, which is measure preserving. And this is a kind of quite, you know, instance of a so-called moment map, which is, has lots of to do with algebraic geometry, and which suggests that there is something profound algebra geometric, which is parallels measure theory and generalized measure theory. But I must say I could never work it out. But it's this good indication that there is something like that. But from our point of view, what is relevant in this map? We use it on a real part of the space. So you have the map from Rn plus, and then the usual metric dpi squared goes to this metric. I think it's factor 1 over 4, because when you differentiate, something some 4 happens. So this map, squaring coordinates, so this is, you have computations the way performed, yeah. So this is a map, this is a moment map. And it's induced metric. So this is a metric associated to Hessian, the one which I wrote before. And this agrees with the metric induced by that. So this is a kind of tremendously simple, but it's rather kind of suggestive. It says that there is something in the entropy in all these things which a priori were not so symmetric. Right? They were not so symmetric. There is this orthogonal symmetry. And so you wonder if you can define entropy without coordinates. Right? So from point of view of the simplex, measure was a bunch of weights attached to these points. And just in this coordinate system, we can compute entropy. Now imagine I change my coordinate system. And so what remains, what can I see of these measures in order to compute the entropy, right? So we want to somehow extend these measures from points to something in the space, so it will be in the language of Euclidean geometry. And so this is exactly what was done by von Neumann. His definition of quantum entropy, but he was working in the complex space, but it's completely immaterial for us, because this, formally the two theories are up to some point. Here I mentioned something about this moment map. So this is a fishy metric which I was reading backwards. Now we come to von Neumann entropy. So, the logic is, as I already mentioned before, we replace symmetric group by orthogonal group, finite set by projective, by real projective space, and this symmetric object will be corresponding to the simplex. It will be, vertices of the simplex will be this Veronese variety, yeah? A projective space embedded into there. So for any linear space, we have a Veronese map, take linear form, take it squared, it goes to the space, sphere goes to the projective space, and so we have this, some linear space, Euclidean space, in fact, and image of this projective space, orthogonal group acting, from where we start, yeah? We don't know anything, and we take the convex hull of that, and the convex hull will be positive definite quadratic forms. And so instead of measures, we have positive definite quadratic forms on Euclidean space. And the background space, our Euclidean space, and which is understood as Euclidean space, not as a linear space. Called Hilbertian structure, which is for some reason forced by quantum mechanics. This, by the way, if you just little digression. So you know there are these three laws formulated by Newton. Yeah. First, there is inertia, the first law, and secondly, that F equals ma, right? Mass by acceleration. So why to do this? Because this is a special case. Why you would isolate that? And mathematically, the point is that you can't forget about the second law. But then what you have, you will have a fine geometry of the space. The first law, kind of, you move along the line, and you move with constant speed, and this gives you a fine geometry of the space. And the second one gives you the metric. And actually, the metric comes because you have square of velocity energies, this energy, which is positive in square of velocity. And this is where Euclidean structure comes from. Physically, it's energy, right? Because it's quadratic in the speed. Yeah. So it's, it's unclear what was, of course, logic in the Newton's head, yeah? But it was not stupid, this separation. And of course, you know, this is a big discussion of what it means, yeah, you know. There's lots of silly people who say lots of nonsense about what it is. And actually, the only place where I found lucid discussion explaining the point of this law is by some writing of Bertrand Russell, who kind of was, and still you can find lots of kind of philosophers and not physicists in physicists, some say it's very, very stupid things about that. So what's the meaning of this law? Why is the law not a definition of force? You know, they say, why you can't say this is just definition of force? So it tells you nothing. Granted, you know concepts of acceleration, you know what is mass, okay, this definition of force. So it tells you nothing. Not at all. Yeah. And the problem, of course, is misuse of the word of definition. It has nothing to do with physics. This is the wrong word. It's usually a nonsensical word. Yeah. Whenever people say, I have a definition of something, except for technical purposes, nonsense. Yeah, okay. But anyway, this is why we have this Euclidean structure. Okay, as a mathematician, you don't want extra structure. We want to kind of try to live without it. So we have Euclidean space with this background quadratic form. I don't know how we call it. P. Called, put here number n, because the trace equals n. Yes, standard form defining n. And then you have other forms. And these are forms, meaning quadratic forms. I think about them as measures, and they're called states in physics. So I change terminology. And probability means trace ones. In a second, I justify it, yeah. Linguistically means probability or density state. Again, language slightly different in quantum mechanics. And it's convenient, so you know every moment about what you talk. They formally the same as probability. So this, so we switched from measures to quadratic form. And now the language is amazingly kind of adequate. And the reason, of course, is the Pythagorean theorem. This makes sense only because there is Pythagorean theorem. This is certainly the number one theorem in mathematics. Namely, so how if you think about this measure? You think about this measure as this science assumption assigning, so usual measure as we had it, we have a finite set and we assign weight to this set, right? Measures is a function on subsets in a set with certain properties. And this, instead of set, because we are in linear algebra, instead of subsets, we have linear subspaces. So this quadratic form gives you a number to every linear subspace. And how it works. First, if it's one-dimensional space, we just take unit vector in there and take the value of this, evaluate this quadratic form at this point. At this vector, and this will be, and this of course agrees with the measure. I just immediately, in a second, I say what happens when how we relate classical quantum mechanics, so to speak. Not mechanics, quantum and probability. And then when you have general subspace, what you do, you choose orthogonal basis, take this value of your function on this basis, and add them together. Like in the space, you take separate points, You take value of mass at each point, add them together. And by Pythagorean theorem, this doesn't depend on which base you take. And that's quite remarkable. It's, otherwise, it would be nowhere. It would be just blah, 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 right? But this is a remarkable thing which allows you to develop, indicates very profound something happening, yeah? And and it has kind of natural properties of imagine separate sets corresponding to orthogonal subspaces. They don't talk to each other, and then this thing is additive. And so this is what we call the states. And they, usually in physics, people prefer to speak about operators, self-adjoint operators. And I don't understand. Mathematically, this is much smoother. With operators, you have to, all the time you have to express it, you have to go back to forms. But of course, I don't know what actually mathematically is the right language in this context. Because this background space, it's the same, the two things are isomorphic. But a priori, they are different objects. Quadratic forms, of course, make sense even without background metric, but of course entropy will not be defined. So the center is by nature is relative entropy. It's entropy of P modulo this background state, which I called N, because N was dimension. Yeah. And in fact, given any two positive definite quadratic forms, you can define this, where this must be with respect to Q have trace one. Because if it's positive definite, it's the same, they're all the same. So this makes sense. But somehow this is not common. People have quite different relative entropy, which I believe is different from that. They write formulas, and the formulas give you something else. Because here, things become, for many reasons, become more subtle. Now you want to define entropy of this thing. And so what we have, just you have just function of the sphere. Look at the union sphere, the rest it is extended, you have weights attached to it. So it's quadratic. We should be using proofs, but not in our definitions at some point. And we want to define entropy, and so what we do, we consider if you take any frame, it gives you, say it's an n-dimensional space, yeah, so you have n numbers. To take a frame of orthonormal vectors, n vectors, you have n numbers. So this is something we know what to do. It's the sum of them equals one. I have a density state. So the sum of these vectors doesn't depend how which base I take. But so it's always sum of one, so it's probability space. And I can take it entropy. So if this was state P, I call it P, and here I put my basis sigma, this probability space, take it entropy. So it makes sense. But this, of course, depends on the frame. Right? So given this kind of observational system, I have, of course, different answers. Now, how to get number out of function. So this depends on sigma. So this one can be used as the definition of entropy of my state, but this depends on the basis. Now you want to take it out. So we have a function, we want a number. And this is a logical thing, yeah? Actually, there are two things to do it, three things to do it. You can take inf, you take it sup, or you take k average. These three basic operations. When you have kind of open formula in logic, yeah, and you want to close it up, you either add existential or universality, right? Function. This is kind of plays the same role. You want to go from function to numbers. Mathematicians like that, because you always can do that. But this usually meaningless, physically meaningless. I mean, infima and suprema are not computable, right? And this, by the way, is I keep repeating it because mathematicians don't know. That was explained to me Mandelbrot. He was explained why his dimension is not at all the same as Hausdorff dimension. You know, fractal dimension introduced by Mandelbrot and Hausdorff dimension, it seems his is a special case of Hausdorff dimension. However, his experience, not at all, Hausdorff dimension is nonsensical because it involves in soup, it's computable. And his requires limits. And therefore, his dimension is not always defined. But when it's defined, you can verify it experimentally, you can do it, you can prove theorems. Hausdorff dimension is just language. It has no substance. And that's, so sometimes he uses infant soup, it's convenient, but it must be understood, it's just notation. They're not kind of real things, yeah, in physics or whatever. Averages make sense. It's infant soup, you just, people love this theorem, the info always exists, soup always exists. They exist because they cost nothing. They're just junk, yeah. But for, as language, we accept it. So anytime now, when I take infant soup, I feel guilty. But fortunately, then a posteriori, you know the things, limits, they exist. They can be, because limit, when you know, you have a limit and you go, you converge. But if you just soup, you go, you know when you have to stop, yeah. Maybe never converge, and then conversion will well be beyond kind of a reason. Okay. And then, so what you take in this example? Of course, soup is not very clever, because you always can find a frame where all values will be equal. This is a little theorem. For quadratic form probably it's obvious, right? So we have true for any continuous function on the sphere. Given continuous function on the sphere, obviously there are full system orthonormal vectors where function takes equal values. And that will be maximal entropy if you belong n. This is a Kakutani somebody else theorem. Actually, I don't know for quadratic form if there is a kind of instantaneous. It's not difficult. Actually, interesting thing about this theorem, it's not difficult, but it's proven by high school, or maybe essentially high school geometry, not by algebraic topology. You think you have to use all the fixed point theorem, some group X and symmetry. You cannot make this proof. But you can make proof by just by continuity. It's kind of so strange. I don't quite understand it, I think. For me, it was a shock when I read the proof. It takes two lines, but it's not the line you expect. Algebraic geometric, topological proof you expect, you know, the thing symmetric under this group, the cyclic group, it takes that, da-da-da. Computer homology and you get it. No, it doesn't seem to work. But you can do it by hand. And for quadratic forms, probably quite easy. It probably it's through algebra, by algebra, over any field or something. But anyway, it doesn't work anyway, so we don't care. So we take infimum, not supreme, but infimum. So what's good about infimum? Now, about entropy, what you know, because you know, of course, this also follows from subadditivity entropy. This P log P is convex function, I believe. I keep forgetting convex or concave. Entropy is concave. So this might be convex. Yeah. So this is concave. This is concave. So concave is meaning like that. Yeah. And if you take infimum of concave functions, again concave. It's trivial, not so bad. So you know entropy, so defined is concave. And however, interestingly enough, this was proven in 1968 by Lanford and Robinson. This was a really big kind of step in statistical quantum statistical mechanics. It was really, at that time, was quite a theorem because they used different definition. That's the whole point about definition. They use analytic definition from where it's not so obvious. And the original definition of phenomenon was, of course, analytic, because coming from quantum mechanics, you have a quadratic form, quadratic form. Any quadratic form can be essentially uniquely diagonalized. And there is some basis such that it become some pi, xi squared, whatever. They become diagonal on some orthonormal basis. If you have an ellipsoid, yeah, it has this principal axis. It will become diagonal. And then, of course, in this you use this as a normal basis. You just use this as a normal basis. and you call this entropy. This is, of course, quite nice in a way because it corresponds to what? That you had this. On this base, you have the Boltzmann entropy, and when you change it, You just don't change the value of the entropy. So it's kind of nice definition. On the other hand, it's not so general as ours because we apply it to any function. And this applies only to quadratic forms. And it's clear the two are equal. And the two are equal by the it follows more or less by wild variational principle. That from any base you can go by any base, kind of rotating it and making them kind of closer and closer. And then kind of, in a second, yeah, I'll show. Because this little computation, which I just can't reproduce, so I wrote them beforehand. And then there is a definition in the spirit of what we had before, and this will be quite essential, so I'll show you this definition. Yeah, by the way, there is something I didn't say, but this will be quite important. There is significant difference. Yeah, so what is the relation, of course, from classical and quantum? So I have this waves pi, you always can write this form. So it becomes quadratic form on this Euclidean space on the index set. You have index set enumerating elements in your probability space. So and this is a quadratic form. And then entropy in one sense becomes entropy in another sense. So that's clear. But the significant difference is that we here allow not necessarily positive, but semi-positive definite quadratic forms. And that when we're speaking about probability spaces, we're preferring to have all atoms of strictly positive weight, completely ignoring atoms of zero weight, which was not quite right. Yeah. In combinatorial discussion, it would never cause any problem. But here it is essential. And and the reason is that there we had this homogeneous state, and in homogeneous spaces where automorphism group was transitive. And for that, you didn't want to have zero atoms because you cannot go from zero to non-zero atom. And here this is impossible. So when you say homogeneous, you have to allow zeros. So zeros quadratic forms look like that. So you have some subspace, and there you have definite form, but then you project everything orthogonally here and take pullback of this form. So this form vanishes on this kernel. So you have to remember this picture, and this makes all the world of difference in the proofs, that you cannot throw away zeros. And then possibly it has some physical meaning, that you cannot kind of isolate your system from the rest of a quantum world. Yeah. Maybe, I don't know, this is, of course, I say it, which I don't understand. But mathematically, you see, because the zero subspace is a big kind of Grassmannian manifold. It's lots of them, yeah. And this, the degenerate forms are everywhere. You cannot get rid of that. And this we call support of the form, and this is kind of null space of the form. So that's our state, yeah. For us, the language state of forms are equivalent. And so this first minimalistic definition which I described, right. So yes, you can see in the writing again. And that's concave. So this is what concavity means. In quadratic form, they have this, they may make a nice convex space, you know, it is just convex hull of this Veronese variety. Right. This Veronese is there all the time, yeah. It's a skeleton of quantum mechanics. Of course, in the complex case, it will be a kind of complex version of Veronese. It will be so something slightly different. And then comes the spectral definition of entropy. I was switching everything to quadratic form of Hermitian, because Hermitian means symmetric. I apologize. Yeah. We don't need complex geometry. The way I wrote it originally, I used Hermitian. But this is completely immaterial. Because after all, every Hermitian form is quadratic. We only concern this quadratic part of this. Yeah, and this is the story. But on the other hand, the spectral definition had the following pleasant features. Yeah. If you take tensor product of spaces, tensor multiply them, entropy will be additive, which is not obvious with general definition, which is not surprising. If you have these general functions, tensor products make no sense. You see this? So it's unclear how to generalize entropy to more general functions with some correct replacement of the tensor product, which I don't know how to do. But this, of course, is quite clear. It's product of entropy, yeah? I'm not mistaken, it's not sum, it's sum. I'm sorry, probably it might be sum, not the product. I wrote it's a while ago, and maybe it is this misprint here. It's of course sum, yeah. It's not product, it's sum there. I'm sorry, because before or after you take logs. I have to. But here I see the mistake, they come back, I cannot see them when I look myself, yeah. Because for product of the space, you know, entropy is as additive, it's not multiplicative, because it takes logs. And now there is another definition, which in the spirit of how we defined entropy for in classical case, but I want to present it in a more kind of, not in this categorical language. The trouble here, there is no good category for Hilbert spaces. There is no morphisms with respect to which entropy behaves in some way. There is something like morphism, but they're not quite. And I really don't know so what should be done about that. I think there might be some refinement, some modification of the categorical language. In a way, they're very much like categories, partly, but then they deviate from this language. And therefore, I have to modify the definition. So, first we define this entropy-dependent conception. So we just kind of approximate it very roughly by kind of constant function, very roughly. And then we go to the high power and go to the limit. So this entropy is very easily controlled by wild variational principle. It's temporary, forget about that, but I want to come to the definition. So it doesn't depend on epsilon. We take any kind of significant part of the space where function is away from kind of extreme zero infinity, and then this measure will be always the same, and this log of this give you, or dimension rather, will give you this number. So see, cardinalities are replaced by dimensions. But of course, the logic of that is the one we had before. We take tensorial power of your space. Now instead of direct products, because products of set correspond to tensor products of corresponding vector spaces. Your quadratic form in the diagonal basis become approximately constant there. So your limit object, it will be this quasi-homogeneous state in the limit. So it will be constant on its support. In support is a subspace such that it's orthogonal complement, the form is vanishes. And all properties of the entropy must follow from properties for these objects, right? And so we have this, it's convenient to have three definitions. They give you three very kind of different simple ideas about what happens. And then we have to, so subadditivity is rather instantaneous because it's equivalent to convexity, if that's easy. But now we have to prove this strong subadditivity, which will be the let me formulate it. So I explain what a canonical reduction, and this is how subadditivity observed. So in quantum mechanics, I'm going to have a system depending on many objects. There's a kind of joint system with the tensor product of them rather than direct product. But they interact, which meaning the state doesn't split into the tensor product. And then people speak about entanglement or something very horrible, which I don't understand. Yeah? So you take a vector and the tensor product is always entangled. Because things, it doesn't have the pure product. So it's not in the image of the segre map. And then when you have this tensor product of two spaces and there is a state, you can project it to one of the factors. And in the language of operators, it's especially nice. Because this makes sense for operators even without any background Euclidean structure. Because on one hand, you know, operators and quadratic forms can go from one to another because they're in the Euclidean space. When you have a tensor product, you have an operator depending on two variables, you can trace it with respect to one variable. And then you have an operator remaining to the second variable. Yeah, I say it, I don't understand. For me, it's kind of too complicated, yeah. But taking this trace, and the fact that trace for linear space of operator is invariant and doesn't depend on the basis is something difficult. But what you can do in the Euclidean space, and this I find much easier, we have this tensor product of two spaces, and this actually for proofs, more general and more flexible. You have a tensor product of two spaces, and you want to go from this tensor, from object on the product to object on the one factor. You see, there is no maps. Between tensor products themselves, there is no map, it's not a direct product, it's a tensor product. Then what you do is as follows. You have any kind of object there, conceivable object. You just take group acting on one of the factors, this full orthogonal group, and average over this group. Now we have object which is symmetric with respect to one group of variables. And then it comes uniquely from something from the second one. Namely, it becomes tensor product of something on the second factor times invariant object on the first one. But if your object are quadratic forms, and the only invariant forms is just standard Euclidean form up to scaling. So this is a canonical operation. So averaging has this effect. So you have this product, and this agrees, you have to, not today, I cannot explain it, agrees with what happens in classical things, and this is the basic formula. Which is strong subadditivity of the entropy. So you have a state in the tensor product, and you can reduce it. And the notation are kind of rather explanatory how you can reduce it. There are many ways you can reduce it. And there is this inequality. So this is subadditivity, so you have many particle system in quantum case. Now the quantum, you have this entropy of this, entropy of that, and this entropy of the two is smaller than the sum of entropies minus this difference. And this is kind of the best you may have. So, and it is non-trivial theorem. It was conjectured in 68 by Lanford and Robinson and proven by Lieb and Ruskai 5 years later. And last summer, there was a meeting here in Paris dedicated to 40 years of the proof of the theorem. It's kind of one of the central theorems of quantum statistical mechanics, and the proofs, you know, it was a conjecture, it was proven, and all proofs, which I know so far, depends on some analytic trick. And myself, on the contrary, I think I have a proof which, well, I guess, well, nothing, but just a tautological proof. So I will explain to you, it's really kind of tautology, if you say it in the right language. Because it's really some equality, inequality between certain operators. But if you formulate it in this way, and use language of non-standard analysis, it becomes tautology. But you have to use, the trouble is with this language, of course, to be sure it's correct. So you must admit that no one of these people who do that accepted what I say. I don't understand what they write, and they don't understand what I write. Yeah. They write formulas, and this is no formula. It seems to me, I think I'm not mistaken, it's just like we prove the usual Shannon equalities. We don't have to write any formulas like logs. They follow from this kind of a functoriality of the entropy and continuity. And here also, there is no functoriality in the usual sense, but it follows from some Euclidean geometry and continuity which replaces functoriality. But I will, of course, have to explain it. How many lectures? I have another two lectures or what? I will not have, finish, of course, what I want. I must say, yeah. Of course, it will take me 1 hour to explain that, and then there will be, of course, other subject. Now, this is what I posted. There are little mistakes I have to correct, like sums and products being confused. I definitely, and after that it's not. So up to this point, yeah, it is kind of more or less edges with minor mistakes, but then the two major, the next subjects are not, yeah. So this I have will explain on the next lecture, the next hour, but then. And then something different starts. So this will be next subject, and this probably only will be able to start it. They will never come to the end. Yeah. So this will be. So tomorrow I'll finish probably with entropy. Next time and explain a little bit maybe Mendelian genetics in this context, because some algebra there is very similar to what happens in quantum mechanics. And then the next lecture, I'll say a little bit about cohomological measures, which is a kind of, we'll not be able, of course, explain it in 2 hours, I think, yeah. But explain something. A different way to think about measures, linearizing them in a deeper way, in a cohomological setting. Okay.